Hi there, I'm Kandace Kerr. Social justice cannot be viewed as an isolated movement. It's a systematic approach to social, political, and economic change. To understand social justice movements, it's important to see the connections between all aspects of life in a particular area. Uses of the land is connected to cycles of poverty, to the retention or the destruction of a traditional life, to poverty, wages, and to homelessness, through to political repression and military terror. The land is the core to all of these connections, and it is through the land that we are able to determine and to understand the importance and the development of social justice movements. Burning Rivers is a film that looks at these connections in the Central American country of Guatemala. From the land and the campesinos, to the multinationals and to the military, there is that central issue of land use. Burning Rivers is being shown throughout the Kootenays, at schools and at public meetings. And in the studio with me today are the producers of Burning Rivers, Merran Smith and Michael Simpson. But first, here's a look at the intro to Burning Rivers.
What's it like to live in a garbage dump? Who killed over 100,000? 100,000 Guatemalans. How do workers survive on $1.50 a day? Where have all the forests gone? Why do rivers burn? Rivers, forests, workers, war, and poverty. How are they linked? Who's pulling the strings? Why are the jungles and streams caught in the crossfire? How big
is... In the studio, the producers of Burning Rivers, Merran Smith and Michael Simpson. Welcome.
Thank you.
That's a lot of questions. What are all those, how are those all connected?
Oh boy.
Let's start off big.
Well, I think if you look at them, the first question, what is it like to live in a garbage dump? Basically what that is representing is poverty. Mm. What is it like to be that poor? The second question, who killed over 100,000 Guatemalans? That's representing more the war and militarism and repression. Mm. How do workers survive on $1.50 a day? Economic injustice. Where have all the forests gone? The environmental degradation. Why do rivers burn? Basically the insanity. I mean, rivers burning, that's such an extreme when water is burning. That's where Guatemala has gotten to. So the idea there was just to introduce the different themes that we were trying to link in the video and set the stage for what was about to come next. Mm.
I guess what we were trying to do too as well, when we originally went down, what we wanted to do was produce a program about Guatemala's environment. And up here there's a real trend to look at the Amazon and to look at rainforest mm-hmm. destruction in different parts of the world. And what became very clear to us very quickly is that to look just at the rainforest destruction in Guatemala is almost impossible, because the reasons for rainforest destruction, it's not just that people want to cut down the forests for hardwoods for use in the first world, it also has a lot to do with campesinos or peasants mm-hmm. in the country not having land anymore that they can survive on. And so they end up moving through slash and burn agriculture higher and higher and deeper into the mountains. And that's just so that they've got a place or a piece of land that they can grow their corn and beans on. And that's a different kind of, it's a different version, because then if we go down and save the rainforest, well, does that mean that we're just going to say no more cutting? Because that's a trend right now is to buy back rainforest, or to see rainforest in isolation of all the other social factors. And I guess that's how we ended up producing this program. It has a lot to do with human rights and a lot to do with, you know, poverty and oppression.
I think one thing is also to bring the understanding that we can't just buy back the rainforest and protect it. That's not even an alternative. I mean, we can buy it back and put the little plaques on our walls saying that we own 10 hectares mm-hmm. of rainforest, but without, you know, we would have to hire an army or something to protect that rainforest if we don't deal with these other issues. Mm. People who are starving are going to cut down the forest if it will enable them to survive for that year or the next year so they can feed their children. So it's not even an alternative.
Mm. That was one thing that was very clear throughout the film, is that you were very good at making those connections and connecting poverty to sort of multinationals, to a need for to be able to go out and farm and feed your family. And there was one thing that struck me as I listened to the film, and that was a quote where the narrator said that to be Mayan is to be described almost like being an attitude. Mm-hmm. And I wondered what your understanding of that was.
I think where that came from is that in Latin America, well, in Guatemala, over 60% of the population is of Mayan descent. And yet, at the same time, there's a strong mixture of Ladino blood and Indian blood. Mm-hmm. And sometimes people, it's hard to understand whether they're, it's difficult to make out whether they're of Ladino descent or Indian descent, but there's definitely a completely different way of thinking about the land that comes from a Mayan. And well, we see it here in Canada as well. In fact, you see it in most Aboriginal cultures where people don't differentiate between the land and their own part. Like, it's oftentimes we take, and this has to do with the history of Europe as well, the fact that we can isolate ourselves from the land, or we can see trees and not see how trees are actually connected to the forest. And that comes up in, because we've done numerous programs with Aboriginal people that are in the programs, and they keep repeating the same things, that you can't see things in isolation. The land is, the trees are never in isolation of the water. The water is never in isolation from the forest. And we, as human beings, are never in isolation from the environment. So there aren't these sort of taxonomic boxes, which is what we tend to do in the Western world, is put things in little boxes and think we can study them all by themselves. And so the Mayans, I think, are very good at seeing the connectedness of all of these things. Not necessarily that the Mayans haven't changed either, because there's definitely been a Western influence and cultural influences, and things are changing, but mm-hmm. traditionally they had a better understanding, I think.
And somebody actually said that to us about being Mayan, that you could actually be of indigenous blood and be of indigenous descent, but you might have taken on the values of the Spanish system, of the Ladino system. So while you are Mayan, you aren't Mayan, because to really be Mayan, it's an attitude. And vice versa, you could not actually be of Mayan descent, but you could have those values. Mm. So they see it more as your actions, not what your bloodline is.
Right. Mm-hmm. Well, you have these two conflicting philosophies. You have a Mayan and a traditional reverence for the land, and then you have a European or I don't know how you want to describe it, but another philosophy with a different perspective, as you were saying, with isolating yourself. What happens when those two conflict? How does that represent itself in a political mm-hmm. sense?
Well, in Guatemala, it's become extreme. I mean, that's how 100,000 people get killed, because the dominant culture, the one with the most power, has managed to be able to kind of look at the other culture. And I mean, and this happens not just in Guatemala. I mean, we do this here in Canada. The Aboriginal people in Canada are seen as somehow different, and that our culture is superior. I mean, this year, in 1992, for example, Canada will be spending $3 million, I think it's $3 million, but anyway, we're building a pavilion in Seville in Spain to celebrate 500 years, to celebrate the fact that Columbus discovered America and that this is a good thing. And for a lot of Aboriginal people, it's not a good thing. So I guess in some ways the question is not just in Guatemala, it's also here. How do we treat our, what have we done? What has our culture done to the first peoples in this country? Mm. It's sort of a rhetorical question in the sense, right? Because if we look at what we have done, it becomes very clear what's happened and what happens when those two cultures come together.
Yeah, I think it's very evident just around here in the hills of the Kootenays as well. And it's that attitude of, almost like the Western frontier attitude, that this is here for ours, it's ours for the taking. And just now, the world is waking up to the fact that we can't just take, that we have to live in unity with the environment which is sustaining us. Mm-hmm. There's an end to the taking.
Right. There's also, just to give you a concrete example, last night we had a show in Slocan City, I think. Is that what the name of the place? Yeah, Slocan City. Anyway, a fellow showed up and he was of indigenous descent and he came from that area, and what he pointed out at one stage is that his culture is viewed as extinct by the government, the Canadian government. And yet he says, yet I'm here, I'm still alive. And I guess that's one consequences is to view all this as past history, as if the indigenous people, well, we killed them all and that's very bad and that's sad and now let's get on with things and get going with progress. But in actual fact, in Guatemala, we're still looking at genocide, and it's happening in Peru and it's happening in other countries of the world. To indigenous in Sarawak, it's happening in East Timor, mm-hmm. and it's happening, some people believe, here in Canada.
One of the statistics that you quote in the film is that two-thirds of the land is owned by 2%,
That's right.
Two-thirds of the land is owned by 2% of the population. Mm-hmm. Who is that 2%? Mm-hmm. Who owns all this land?
It's 2% of the Guatemalan population. Mm-hmm. There are foreign landowners, mostly Americans, Europeans, but mostly that is Guatemalans, and that elite has formed, it started 500 years ago when the Spaniards arrived and basically took the land, felt that, you know, they were the conquestors, mm-hmm. and that this was now theirs, and started the system of large plantations, kicking off the indigenous people who were there. And that system has continued. Mostly, in most of Central America, it is still the same. In Guatemala, in El Salvador, the country to the south, there's actually 14 families they talk about. In Guatemala, it's about 200 families. It's not quite as small. Right. And that 2%, they're the ones who you see in the film as well, who live an incredibly rich life and who are often very connected to the army. And in addition, now the army is one of the big landholders in Guatemala. During the 30 years that there was a military dictatorship, they amassed more and more land. They built roads into the rainforest and opened up new areas of the country and also bought land. And they have become an incredibly powerful force now, because while there is a civilian government, the military owns its own bank. It owns so much land that they're a power that they need to be reckoned with. You can't just turn to a civilian government and expect them to step back and to follow the orders from the civilian government. They have power, and consequently, right now, most people would say that the military is still in charge in Guatemala and that the civilian government takes its direction from what the military wants. And there's been a few cases where that's seen. For instance, the government tried to make the press a little bit more liberal, because formerly the press is very much controlled, and what you read in Guatemala in the press is different than what we can get out here. We know more about what's going on in Guatemala than what Guatemalans know. Mm-hmm. And so they liberalized things, and a couple of new press agencies opened up, and they were reporting a bit more about what the truth was. You know, the numbers of people who were dying, who was killing them, or who was implicated in the killings, who, you know, whether death squad vehicles were around or the military. And after about 6 months, they were bombed, and there was death threats given to foreign correspondents who had come in from Cuba and from other Eastern Bloc nations. And so that sort of small opening of press freedom was quickly closed down. Mm-hmm. And why was that? Well, obviously, the military didn't want that kind of information getting out of the country. Right. And, you know, we can see that here in Canada. How much Guatemalan news is ever on any of our news coverage, or mm-hmm. NBC, CBC, mm-hmm. or ABC from the States?
But all we see are the elections, and we get these stories all the time about how this is a wonderful, great, and democratic election. Mm-hmm. But my understanding of the election process in Guatemala is that it's anything but democratic.
Well, I believe there's, 20 candidates killed? In the last, was it 20? Yeah, 20 candidates killed in the last, in the electoral process, which says something about being a candidate in Guatemala.
And that, I mean, the left-wing parties don't even operate. Those are center parties, the candidates who are getting killed. The left-wing parties, anyone who is slightly left of center, is in exile. They're in Mexico or Central America, mm-hmm. operating out of there.
Recently we spoke, when we were down there, we were on a human rights delegation at one point, and so we ended up speaking with a lot of different people throughout the country, and one of those fellows, Amilcar Mendez, who works with a group called Serge, which is a group of indigenous people, and he's a lawyer, he works on the legal end of things anyway. He came to Canada, and he was telling us what the statistic is, right? It's about 200 assassinations or killings a month, and that's in the last year since this new government came in. So the new government came in, civilian government, and said, give us a chance, you know, we're new, and so this human rights thing, just, you know, slow down a bit on your criticisms and give us a chance. And things just started to get worse and worse, to the point, 200 a month. Of course, you can break that figure up and figure out how many that is a day, and then how many, blah, blah, blah. Mm-hmm. But it's quite striking, you know. And that's 200 political assassinations where people are thinking about leaders. They're knocking out the leaders in the country, the student leaders, etc. So it gets quite, sort of says something about the democracy in mm-hmm. Guatemala.
A couple of other indicators about democracy are that, I mean, in our system, democracy means you have the right to not vote. That can be your vote, is to not vote. In Guatemala, your cards, your papers get stamped when you vote. You always have to have those papers on you, because there's military checkpoints all on the roads. You always have to have your papers. If you don't, you're questioned and taken into a military station for that. Now, if they see that you haven't voted, you're hauled in for that as well. That is questionable. Why mm-hmm. didn't you vote? So just the fact that you can't even choose not to vote is a statement. And in addition, we just talked about the press. If there's no freedom of press, if there's no left-wing parties who are able to run, if 20 candidates get killed, I mean, it all adds up to very little democracy.
Yeah. Well, hearing that then, one of the more striking images from the film all becomes much more striking and much more dangerous, and that is the whole nature of political demonstration and opposition. Mm-hmm. It must be non-existent almost, although in the film you have some very empowering footage of mm-hmm. a demonstration.
I would say it's there and it's very evident. We first went in, I guess, 1986. You see, the early 1980s, from 1978 to about 83, 84, was really extreme. That's when there was like 440 villages, entire villages massacred. And that's when these statistics really started to get really high in terms of killings. So when we got there in 1986 the first time, everything was quiet. People wouldn't talk. And yet when we went this time, and I went a second time, and then this third time we went specifically to talk to people to make this film and to get a clear idea of the environmental situation. And that time it was amazing. People were talking. They're out on the streets. We went to several demonstrations. Demonstrations were happening all the time, and people would be out spray painting the walls, you know, and you see in the film pictures of everybody out there with signs, you know, putting their lives on the line, essentially. I mean, one demonstration we went to, there's a guy got disappeared after the demonstration, but there's more demonstrations. We went to one union factory where the union was trying to gain laboral stability. That's all they wanted, was laboral stability. They didn't want more money, nothing, just laboral stability. And eventually it all got broken up by police and everything, but they did a demonstration as well, really gutsy. So in some ways, it's the exact opposite. People are speaking out in Guatemala. There's definitely a sense of timing right now in the country, that things are changing throughout Latin America. The Eastern Bloc has collapsed, so there really is no rational reason for the United States to be supporting the government. The government doesn't really have a good case that everybody's a communist. I mean, I've been called a communist, and I don't think... In El Salvador, I was called a communist at one point. I mean, I'm a small business person here in Canada. We run a video company. We're not exactly communists, but that's the kind of labeling that happens with people. And what's interesting is that people are reversing that whole process, and just out on the streets anyway. And you can, you know, people say, well, you can call me a communist if you want, but I'm here for my children or for whatever reason.
I think that's the point. People are out in the street because the situation has been so bad, and it still is. Their economic situation is unbearable, that they're saying, we are starving to death. You are starving us to death, because there's plenty of food in Guatemala. And so we won't stand for this. It's got to the point that we'll put our lives on the line for it. But perhaps we should go to the clip of the video. There's some that very graphically shows what the people do.
A struggle for land and justice. A struggle that has been met with bullets and grenades by an efficient and well-armed military. A struggle that has not stopped since 1954, when the last attempts at land reform were crushed by the military, a military that was and still is armed and aided by the United States.
Why is the American government supporting the military? What is there for them to be supporting them for?
Well, it's an interesting question, because they have supported the military for years and years. In this moment right now, the Americans have cut their military aid to Guatemala, and we can get into that in a second. Why they've supported them in the past is a number of reasons. One, that fear of communism, the domino theory, which Reagan talked about a lot, that Nicaragua had fallen to the communists and that, you know, it was going to go up through Honduras, El Salvador, Guatemala, Mexico, and the United States was next. And we had to stop that communism at whatever cost. And if that meant funding governments to fight the communism, that's what it took. And for that, that was their explanation of why they were funding the militaries. But if you look at another issue, and that's the whole economic issue, the American factories, the American-owned plantations, the huge American investment in all of Latin America, that those companies are making enormous profits, and they're making enormous profits at the expense of the workers. If those workers were getting Canadian-type wages, the companies would not make the profits. They could probably still produce the products and still sell them for somewhere around the same price, just they wouldn't make the profits. So that has a lot to do with it as well. And if you look at Guatemala in the 40s, the United Fruit Company, it was called then, was an American-owned corporation which grew pineapples and bananas, or maybe just bananas.
Yeah.
And the Guatemalan government at that time, there was a democratically elected government, and they started to put in land reform. They started taking all the land which was not being used, that was lying fallow, and buying it from the companies for the price that the companies were declaring on their tax forms.
Which wasn't very much.
And so buying that and giving it back to the campesinos, putting in a land reform situation. And that, of course, made the companies very mad because, I mean, they had lied saying their land was worth so little, and now they were saying, well, it's worth more than that, and, you know, we don't want to sell it off even though we're not doing anything with it. And if you look deeper, who was on the United Fruit Company's board of directors? Well, there's really strong connections to the U.S. government, to, I don't remember exactly, one relative of John Foster Dulles, who was the Secretary of State. In 1954, the U.S. orchestrated, a CIA orchestrated a coup which removed that democratic civilian government in Guatemala. So that's probably the first and most blatant example of U.S. intervention to protect the rights of U.S. companies. And so that would be one of the main reasons.
I guess the thing too about the film is I hope that people don't get the impression that we're just talking about Guatemala. Because although, I mean, the trend in Guatemala has been that there has been U.S. intervention. I mean, this has happened in El Salvador. $1.5 million a day for years has gone into El Salvador in military aid. And it's happening as well in other countries. Honduras has got five huge air bases. I think it's the second largest American installation. I'm just pointing that out because it's what we're trying to get across in the film is that these countries don't, the disparity that exists in the country doesn't happen just because of the people in the country. There's a strong international influence. And if it isn't the United States, there's Canadian involvement. And in Africa, there's European involvement.
What's the level of Canadian involvement?
In Guatemala?
In Guatemala itself.
Mm. Well, let me think.
Canada gives about $9 million of bilateral aid. So we give no military aid. This economic aid is government-to-government aid. And it is supposed to go to the poorest of the poor. One, like myself, would argue with that. A, by giving government-to-government aid, we're recognizing the Guatemalan government. We're legitimizing them, saying, you know, it doesn't matter that you're committing 200 human rights abuses a month. You're still an okay guy, and we'll give you $9 million bucks. Mm-hmm. And the second reason is that money actually getting to the poorest of the poor? So going through non-governmental organizations appears to be a better way.
Some of these are sort of funny questions too, because for example, the engines that are made for Huey helicopters, well, those are made in Canada. So is that American involvement or is that Canadian involvement? At what point are we involved, you know? And there's lots of examples like that of our goods, manufactured goods, going to third world countries, and then in exchange, we get their natural resources. And when you see that cycle after a while, it becomes very evident what we're gaining out of this.
I mean, what are some other connections? The coffee I just bought down the street was Guatemalan coffee. Levi's jeans, manufactured by women being paid $2 a day in Guatemala. There's many, many connections between our lives and Guatemala, and probably more connections through trade than there are through aid and our government-to-government thing.
I guess traditionally, too, just to be more specific with the Canadian question, the largest single monetary or economic influence in Guatemala a few years ago was Inco out of Sudbury, a nickel manufacturing company. And it's interesting too, because that's a huge environmental question. They set up on Lago de Chavel, which is this lake in northern Guatemala, in the Payten. And that area was, I mean, there was lots of environmental problems going on there with the nickel mine, because you can imagine, you know, in Guatemala, how few environmental regulations there would be. But that wasn't really, like, the big issue there, in a lot of ways, was the workers and the people that were being displaced, and also the fact that, you know, the Guatemalan, the railroads that were built and the roads and all the infrastructure, and then and INCO, the fact that they're moving their nickels, they're paying people a decent wage in Canada, and instead they move everything down south where they can pay people almost nothing. And I mean, we're seeing the whole thing again happen again now with Mexico. We're going to get into a free trade agreement with Mexico in which we're going to do the exact same thing. Mm-hmm. So but it's not just Guatemala. I mean, we can look at Chile, or we can look at Brazil, or we can look at, I mean, we have forest companies in Brazil that are cutting the forests. So, I mean, it's a matter of how deeply you want to look.
Yeah. We just have a couple of minutes left. I wish we had a lot more time. Yeah. What can Canadians do, or what can we do to start redirecting this balance and redressing it?
Well, it's not, it's a question that we need a whole other half hour to talk about, because obviously it's a very, by connecting all those issues together, suddenly you have a huge mass of something to deal with. And in some respects, you need to chop it all back down again to try to deal with it piece by piece by piece. The first thing that I think Canadians need to do is to look at their own lives and analyze, you know, what it is that you can do on a personal level just by changing your lifestyle. And also look at what's going on around you. I don't think that we're advocating, while definitely Guatemala does need some support from outside, they have the answers to their own problems. There's, you know, hundreds and hundreds of people there working in groups who have solutions. They know what Guatemala needs. They need support in terms of some political support so they can have the space to do it. But I mean, we also have the issues up here as well. Who owns our forest companies who are depleting our resources here? Where are the profits going? What's the long-term situation? So I think, I'm not really giving you any specific answers here, but I think understanding, educating yourself more, finding out where your products are coming from, questioning your consumption, using your consumer power where you can, writing political letters, getting involved in a political process, finding out what groups are in your area doing something, working with people rather than trying to work as individuals.
Mm-hmm. That's definitely something that can happen in Nelson as well, because, for example, this tour that we're on right now is sponsored by a group that works very, very hard in Nelson for that, you know, with the idea of solidarity with Central America in mind. And that's the big thing that we've been telling people. People say, what can we do, what can we do? And we say, well, the first step is just to get to know more about what's going on and not to do that in isolation. Because if you do that as an individual, that's disempowering. But if you do that in conjunction with other people, then it's much easier to get involved and find out more and not to feel like this whole thing is overwhelming, because it's not.
There's certainly a lot of things that individuals can do and power that we can have. We can tell you many stories of how letter writing, one simple thing, letter writing, has succeeded. And even talking with activists here in the Kootenays, when we tell these success stories, they say, wow, how did you know that? Like, we need to know that. And that is a problem, is that people write letters and don't ever find out what happened. And there's many, many success stories, people getting out of jails, government changing policies. Just recently, Canada changed its position on the Guatemalan human rights situation solely due to letter writing.
I want to thank both of you very much for coming in today. I wish you great success with the film and with the tour. I won't ask you what you're doing next, because we'll have to wait and you'll come back, but thank you very much for coming in. And thank you to our feline friend who popped up out of nowhere.
That's great. Hello, Kat. Thank you for the opportunity to come, because we always appreciate being able to talk about these issues.
Great. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Michael Simpson and Merran Smith, they're the producers of Burning Rivers. I'm Kandace Kerr. Thanks for watching.